Yeah, thank you. So the talk is not about TBA, but it's about the Kuznetsov formula. Kloostermania. And applications. So I guess today's talk, I'll start with the middle one, Kloostermania. So just start with the basic definitions of Kloosterman sums. So it's an analytic number theory talk, so I'll always use this notation. And we'll let m, n, and c be integers. And so the classical Kloosterman sum is the following exponential sum. So the classical notation is S, M, N, C. So it's a sum over x running through z mod c invertible, mx plus mx inverse over c. So here, often, I'll write, I guess this goes in sort of the notation section, that this x over invertible elements, often I'll write just x with a little star above the sum here. OK, so that's a Kloosterman sum. And these have various kind of properties that you can check, pretty elementary. So like S of M, N, C is the same as S of minus M, M, minus N, C, which is the same as the complex conjugate of M, N, C. So the whole thing is always a real number. Maybe if M and C are relatively prime, I can slide the M to the next entry. And they also factor, okay? So it's a multiplicative function in C, but it has sort of a twisted multiplicativity. So C is C1 times C2, with C1 and C2 relatively prime, has a sort of property like this. M C1 bar N C1 bar C2 S of M C2 bar N, C2 bar C1 is the whole SMNC. All right, so all of these things you can just check directly. It's good to have at the tip of your tongue. So these have a long and old history. So they're introduced by Kloosterman. A long time ago. So I think most everything in this talk will be ancient history, pre-World War II. So he introduced them to study quadratic forms. To study this representation number, R, A, B, C, D of n, which is the number of x in z to the fourth, such that n is equal to a x1 squared plus b x2 squared plus c x3 squared plus d x fourth. Okay? So I think using the circle method. So I think Kloosterman's original application of the circle method to study these representation numbers of these quadratic forms is actually a really kind of nice, quick example to show you how Kloosterman sums come up in actual arithmetic problems. So actually, Kloosterman's method doesn't just apply to diagonal forms in four variables, but much more generally. Okay, so now I'm going to present it. So I'm going to let Q be a quadratic form in R variables. So x1 up to XR. It's a positive definite quadratic form in R, at least four variables, and I'm going to assume R is even. For this talk, but you can make a lot of this, you can make all of this work for odd R's also. But just to kind of simplify me writing too much on the board, I'm just going to do R even. Okay. So let's see. So I can write Q of X. I can write, let's see, I can write A to be the matrix associated with Q. It's a symmetric matrix. To Q, so sometimes we'll write Q of X is 1 half A brackets X, or 1 half X transpose A X, or even, so this is some AII X I squared plus sum over I less than J of A, I, J, X, I, X, J. Okay. Okay, so maybe some other kind of constants that will come. So I'm going to let D be minus 1 to the R over 2 times the determinant of A. This is the discriminant of Q. And I'm also going to let N, an integer is any integer for which n times A inverse is an integral matrix, an R by R matrix of integers. Okay. So there's a minimal such n, but I think everything I'm going to write, maybe I'll have to take the minimal later, but we'll see. Okay, great. So there's a really, the whole theme of the talk is there's a very interesting relationship between modular forms and these Kloosterman sums. So, and the circle method's a nice way of seeing how that comes out in practice. So I'm going to let also theta be the theta function associated with Q. So it's the sum over, say, I'll let M run on the ZR lattice, E of Z, Q of M. And of course, if you write out its Fourier series, these representation numbers, R and Q, it's the number of representations of Q of N by the form Q, are just the Fourier series. So the game is going to be to try to study this number R and Q. So this is some sort of generating series like the ones Philippe introduced this morning. Like he was saying, some of these have nice symmetry properties. So this theta function is a modular form. So theta is a modular form. It's of level n, and weight r over 2, and central character given by the quadratic character D on the Legendre symbol, D over something, where D is this discriminant. So this means for all gamma in this congruent subgroup, gamma naught of n, that theta of gamma z is going to transform like, so maybe I'll write this A, B, C, D. D on D, C Cz plus d to k theta of z. Okay, and also it's a holomorphic function and is holomorphic into each of the cusps. So I should say here, z, of course, is going to always be in the upper half plane. OK, so if we want to study this representation number, we want to study r, n, q. OK, well, it's the Fourier coefficient of theta of z, e of minus n z dx. And so we're integrating around a circle, and we're doing the circle method. And this theta function is going to have different behavior if we're very close to a rational number or very far from a rational number with small denominator. So we have to break up this integral into pieces and use this modularity relation. So the way we're going to do this is using a Kloosterman circle method. OK, so we're going to introduce the Ferry fractions. Of depth C. So these are going to be a set of rational numbers A over C such that, OK, of course, it has to be in lowest terms. And then the denominator is just going to go up to capital C. And then this, let's see, I'll write, if I write the fractions in the real number order, say I'll write a prime over c prime less than a over c less than a prime prime over c prime prime, the adjacent fractions, and then let m a over c, this is called the Ferry set segment around A, the fraction A over C. So it's just going to be given by A plus A prime over C plus C prime, A plus A double prime over C plus C double prime. And you can check that it can also be written this way. So maybe, OK, it's supposed to be a mini course. So here's two quick exercises that you can check for yourself. So these numbers here are called the medians. So you should check that the medians are not in Ferry fractions of depth capital C. And there's also a nice way of giving the C prime and the C prime and the C double prime the adjacent two fractions in terms of just C and A alone. So so C prime and C prime prime are the unique numbers satisfying. So it's C minus C is less than C prime runs up to C, such that A C prime is 1 mod C, or C minus C C prime prime, such that A C prime prime is minus 1 mod C, and then then A prime is given by A C prime minus 1 over C, and A prime prime is given by A C prime prime plus 1 over C. OK, and then we can use this to compute these Fourier coefficients. OK, so I'll let F be a function on the real line. Let's say it's periodic mod 1. And so then if I want to compute Fourier coefficient, I can break it up according to these this decomposition, which kind of controls for how big the denominator is around each of these Fourier points. So this ends up being a double sum. Let's see, I guess there's a question of whether you should take, if C is 1, whether I should take A to be 0 or 1, but I'll take A to be 0. So the 0 is in this set, but not 1, if I'm going to split it over just one interval 0 to 1. So this, let's see, A is going to go up to C, go up to C with A and C relatively prime. And I'm going to split it over these intervals. So this is just the same thing. It's running 1 over C, C plus C prime prime, 1 over C, C prime, F of x minus A over C, dx. So I can change, let me write D for C plus C prime or C plus C double prime. So this ends up being a sum over A and D now, or sorry, C and D now. Okay, so I guess the C will start down at 1 and run up to C, and then D will run up to C plus C, where D and C are now relatively prime. I'm going to have something like this. So then if I assume F has real Fourier coefficients, this gives the following useful formula. Okay, this just comes out to be 2 times the real part, a sum over C, integral 0 up to 1 over C times C of sum over, we'll leave the D part on the inside. Okay. So this breaking this up into these intervals gives you a nice way of computing these Fourier coefficients, which is one of our games for giving these sums of arithmetic functions, where our generating function has some sort of dependency is big or small, whether I'm close to a rational number with large denominator or not. Okay? And so we're going to try to apply this to this data function. Okay, so we want the nth Fourier coefficient of our theta function. So let's take the theta function of z e to the minus n x dx. So this is going to be just applying our Fourier fraction decomposition. So we have this sum over C on the outside. So of course, D bar over C means D inverse mod C. I didn't write that anywhere. So, okay, you're all used to that. Okay, okay. So let's see. Where's the best place to write it? I have a little spot here. So, if D and C are relatively prime, often it's typical in analytic number theory that we write D bar is the same thing as the inverse in Z mod C invertible. Then I have an E of minus nx dx. OK, so this is kind of the interesting part sitting on the inside here. And so let me pull that out and see what we can do with that. Maybe I'll give it a name. I'll call it T of, let's see, there's an N in there, there's a C, and there's a x. So what we want to do is use this symmetry. That's kind of the interesting part about theta, is theta is a modular form. So it has this nice transformation property. So and the next step is just to apply that transformation property to this theta and figure out what it does to this t. So maybe I'll write as a lemma a version of this modularity relation. So particularly, I'm only going to use the following formula, which you can use to prove that theta is a modular form, in fact. So I'm going to assume here that A and C are relatively prime. And so the formula says that theta of Z minus A over C is going to be the determinant of A to the negative 1/2. C to the minus R, I over Z to the R over 2, and then a sum over the M's running through the Z to the R lattice of, OK, so this GM is going to be a Gauss sum. And here I'm going to have A inverse turned into a quadratic form over C squared Z. OK, so I have to tell you what this Gauss sum is. So gm of a bar over c is the following thing. So now I'm going to sum over h running over z mod c r copies of that. E of a bar over c of q of h plus h transpose m. Okay. So this is a quadratic Gauss sum in particular, and we all are familiar with, if we have a Gauss sum in one variable, we can give an explicit formula for that Gauss sum. And so here it's possible to do the same sort of thing. We just have to diagonalize and do it r times. I'll come back to that later, but this, you should think of this Gauss sum as not something mysterious, but something we can give a closed form expression for. OK, so I'm going to take this as a black box, but maybe we'll just say the proof is Poisson summation. So there's nothing kind of deeper than a careful application of Poisson summation that goes into the proof. But it ends up giving you something pretty nice. OK, so OK, so this t function now of, I said n, c, and x. OK, so I just plug in this transformation property, which is one of the modularity properties of this theta function. A lot of the things just pull out. What is it? So c to the minus ri over z, the r over 2. And I get a sum over the lattice, gm of d over c, e of n d bar over c. OK, so, oh, and then I also forgot that interesting sum over the d's. So that goes in the middle here. So what do I got? C less than d less than or equal to c plus c. C and d relatively prime, and c d x less than 1. So maybe that's going to all be thought of as one chunk. And then I have what left over from this piece here, a inverse evaluated on M. OK, so again, I'm going to pull out the thing on the inside. And I claim that this, after a little massaging, is going to turn into exactly a Kloosterman sum. So here, OK, not exactly a Kloosterman sum, but after a little massaging, it's going to essentially be a Kloosterman sum. Which way did I write it? N comes first. So, OK, I haven't told you what the explicit evaluation is, but one of the annoying problems here is that it's actually an incomplete sum. So first thing we have to do is complete the sum. So there's a pretty standard way of doing this sort of thing. I want to separate out this condition on the inequality with the condition from the relatively prime. So I'm actually going to write t m NCX is going to be a sum. Okay, so I'm going to introduce a new variable. So I'm going to call it B instead of D now, C plus C. And I'm also going to have C, B, X less than 1. And here now this sum over D is going to be running mod C with D and C relatively prime. And then through both of these, there's going to be the condition B is D mod B is, well, OK, B is, of course, B mod C. B is D mod C. OK. And then we can just use additive characters to separate that out. So this is going to be a sum over a new variable, L of C, where I have this sum over the B's, E of L, B over C, maybe with a 1 over C out here. And then I'm also going to have a sum over the D's. So it turns out this sum over the B's, OK, here it still has all these conditions, right? I left them off here just to save myself from writing a little bit. OK, so maybe if I put the 1 over C on the inside, so this maybe turns into the minimum between C plus C and 1 over CX, E of LB over C. So this, this is pretty harmless, actually. You can actually show that this is less than like 1 plus absolute values of L. So of course, if L is 0, it's just 1. And then if L is not 0, I can write this just as a geometric series and estimate it kind of obviously to get this. So this extra piece here with the 1 over C and the sum over B doesn't hurt us too much. And then this complete sum, after I put in this evaluation for this quadratic L sum, turns into a Kloosterman sum. So let me give you that evaluation for the Gauss sum. So there's one irritating technical detail, which is that this lemma has some hypotheses which are not always true here. But OK, maybe it's just a proof sketch. So if C is relatively prime to twice the determinant of A, I'll put the D out here, D and the determinant of A, then we can evaluate this Gauss sum exactly. So I get something like this. So here's the Legendre symbol of the determinant of A on C. OK, so it is what it is. 2C to the R over 2, E to the minus D bar over C, and then 1/2 of A inverse, and let's see, variables M. And I should have, good. OK, so if C is not relatively prime here, you have to come up with some other argument. But I think this is the generic case, and that's sort of the essence of what's going on. So maybe it's not really a It's a proof sketch. So under this hypothesis, let's see, we end up having that this complete sum on the inside GM of D over C turns out to just be, okay, carrying through some of the stuff from this evaluation. And the interesting part is D mod C relatively prime, E minus L D plus N D bar. Minus d bar 1/2 a m inverse over c. And then this thing is just the Kloosterman sum, which I introduced earlier. OK, so we unpacked things like three times. But I think you can see kind of all the pieces. So let's see, it started over here. So we want to study the representation number of the quadratic form. I can write it as that integral over there. And it kind of comes down to a sum over C. And then C ends up turning into, I left one thing off here, the modulus of this Kloosterman sum. OK, so I'll have to do some completing, but I argue that this sort of sum is basically harmless, because the B sum has some decay. And putting it all back together, you kind of have a sum of these Kloosterman sums of modulus C over the modulus. And now, actually, all we need to win is any sort of, in this particular case, all we need to win is any non-trivial bound on this Kloosterman sum. Trying to find an asymptotic formula for the number, the representation number. Yeah. As n goes to infinity. So to conclude an asymptotic formula, for n going to infinity, any non-trivial bound on S M and C suffices. Okay. And to give such a bound, so what Kloosterman did.
So can you just explain why is this issue?
OK, so you would have to do the calculation. But if I treat everything else on this blackboard trivially, and I just take absolute value upper bounds and any sort of thing like this Lissandre symbol, I just bound it by one and do everything trivially. All you need is a non-trivial bound on this Kloosterman sum, and then you can, that suffices to prove the formula. If you just treat everything else with, you don't need any more cancellation beyond what's in the Kloosterman sum.
Wouldn't you need, say that n, say, is coprime with the discriminant and be n or something like this, because
n. You mean to pass local conditions, or
coefficient, the integral number you want to represent?
Yeah. Well, I guess.
Problem with coprimality, with discriminant, or with.
So, once you pull out the main term, to show that the main term doesn't vanish, there'll be perhaps hypotheses like that.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, but up to this point.
Because the main term will contact the local
global. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's right, it'll go into the error term, yeah. So the main term will come from where in this argument? So let's see, where's the, it'll come from exactly the zero Fourier frequency. So here, I have this sum over m, and the m equals zero term in this sum is the main term. So this won't apply to m equals zero, but I'll have to pull that out, and that'll give me a main term, and then doing everything else trivially will give me the result. The main term could be zero, yeah, if there's local reasons why the quadratic form doesn't represent everything. Absolutely, yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, so what Kloosterman showed to get at this, to give a bound for this Kloosterman sum was he actually used the method of moments. Okay, so Kloosterman took a sum over all m's which are not zero. M mod C, or, okay, so I'll just say M P star of S M N P, where P is a prime. Okay, P is always a prime. And he showed that this was less than 16 P cubed. Okay, and from this you can conclude that one of these S M N P's is less than 2 P to 3/4, okay, and of course the trivial bound being p. So okay, Kloosterman was able to succeed this way. Okay, so one more thing I just want to point out about this is you can see there's some sort of connection going on here between this theta function, which is a modular form, and these Kloosterman sums that come out. Okay, so this is just sort of a glimpse of it in a nice arithmetic application. But this connection was made a lot more explicit a bit later by Peterson. Still ancient history here. So Peterson made this connection more explicit in his famous formula, which we call the Peterson formula nowadays. So just to introduce this, I'm going to let S K Q chi be the C vector space of cusp forms of classical holomorphic cusp forms So for the congruence subgroup gamma naught of Q and character chi and weight K. So I'll write that for gamma naught of Q. Weight K, central character, chi, which is a Dirichlet character mod Q. Okay. So Peterson also introduced the following inner product on the space of modular forms. It's given by integration, of course. But it's adapted to the weight. So this would be the usual R measure on the upper half plane, but here it's adapted to the weight of the modular forms involved. Okay, so okay, so then also I'm going to let B, K, Q, chi be an orthonormal basis for space and modular forms. Okay, so then the Peterson formula says that if I take the sum of Fourier coefficients through this orthonormal basis, okay, there's some normalization that has to happen. This has this following really nice expression, 2 pi I to the minus k, and then a sum over C which Q divides the C of this Kloosterman sum times some weight. So it's times this Bessel function. Okay, this J is a Bessel function, so I'll tell you what it is. Okay, so that's the formula. Oh, yeah. Thank you.
So,
yes, I'm about to do so. I also have to say what the Bessel function is. Okay, so, yes?
I made a small historic correction.
Oh, thank you.
This formula is essentially due to Petrow, but it's not from 1939.
The
Petrow did two things.
Inner product was from 39.
Right. In 1939, he computed the Fourier coefficients of Poincaré series.
Uh-huh.
And then later, in the late 40s, he introduced what is now called the Petrow inner product, what he wrote down there.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
He attributes it to Petrow, which is completely correct, except that Petrow never wrote it down. Mm-hmm. He just gave all the ingredients.
Yeah.
In these two papers, one in 1939 and the other one in, I don't know,
40-something. Okay, thanks. And in the next lecture, I'll prove the formula so it'll be more clear what the Poincaré series and the Fourier expansion of the Poincaré series and all that is. Next lecture. So, okay, so there's a... There's an extra chi here, so it's not exactly the same Kloosterman sum, but this S chi of M and C is the same thing, but with an extra twisted by chi inside the formula. Okay, so now I'll feel free to use the bar here, where I told myself before the lecture I was going to write inverse instead of bar everywhere, because it's really just the inverse, but old habits die hard. So what are you going to do? Okay, so that's the Kloosterman sum with the character. And so J nu of x, this Bessel function, I'll define it like a calculus lecture with a picture. It looks like this. So here it's asymptotic to 1 over nu factorial x over 2 to the new. And out here it looks like x to the minus 1/2 times sine x. So when I say looks like, I mean, OK, it might have an extra constant out front. And I'm not sure I got exactly the phase right, but it has a very regular period here. It looks very, OK, it's nice. And then this point here is, again, approximately the point nu, comma, nu to the minus 1/3. And I think those are all the standard sort of features of this Bessel function that people who work with this just kind of know off the top of their head. I'll give, again, when I prove the formula in the next lecture, I'll give you an actual definition of the Bessel function. But that's what it looks like. Great. OK, so. Maybe just tying up a few more details here. So I said it suffices to bound this sum, but I told you that Kloosterman bounded it for a prime in the last entry. So it turns out the case where it's a prime is the most interesting, or the most the only non-trivial case. So I said at the beginning that these Kloosterman sums are multiplicative, so they factor. So it suffices to look at them on prime powers. Okay, so the next goal is to, we want to bound these Kloosterman sums. So by multiplicativity, it suffices to understand S of M and, okay, so for the next discussion, I'm going to restrict myself to trivial central character, but you can make all of this work for a non-trivial central character also, but I'll stick to the trivial central character for the minute. P to the V, where P is a prime, of course. Okay, so it turns out that the cases V bigger than or equal to 2 are easy. To understand exactly what happens with this Kloosterman sum. It's a completely elementary calculation to bound these Kloosterman sums almost exactly. And we can actually do it not just for Kloosterman sums, but for exponential sums much more generally. And so I think it's important to understand this to understand why, say, in Philippe's lectures coming up on L-adic trace functions, we'll focus on the case of a prime modulus for the exponential sums. So let me say Q is a prime power. And I'm going to let F and G be rational functions with integer coefficients. And then chi is a Dirichlet character. Mod Q, and C is an additive character. Mod Q. So in general, we're going to study exponential sums of the following kind. So any f of x, g of x, where x runs mod q. So I should add a star here. So if I write, so the star now means if I write writing, OK, star means that this expression makes sense. OK, these are rational functions that might have denominators. So if I write f of x as f1 of x over f0 x, what is chi of f of x? I really mean chi of f of 1 of x, f0 of x inverse mod q. And so this star means that x always runs relatively prime to f0 of x and g0 of x. To q. OK? And similarly for c of g of x. And so it turns out, except in the case where n is equal to 1, I can basically understand these exponential sums completely using completely elementary arguments. Okay, so just maybe as an example, lemma. So I'll let q be p to the 2 alpha with alpha at least 1. So then S of chi psi is just going to be equal to p to the alpha sum over y running mod p to the alpha, where some polynomial, which I'll write down in just a minute, is 0 mod p to the alpha with chi of the usual things. OK, so this really finished. Oh, I have to write down what h is. So I'm going to let my additive character of x be define a by whatever a inside this complex exponential gives the additive character. And then chi of 1 plus zp to the alpha is also given by, is also an additive character. So I'll define b this way. And then this polynomial h is the following thing. So h of y is a g prime of y plus b f prime over f of y. Yeah. So it's a Dirichlet character mod Q. So then if I take 1 plus, it should be an additive character. Yeah. Okay, so the let's see. Maybe the proof is we write z as y plus x p to the alpha. Okay, and then my s of chi psi y runs mod p to the alpha. Y relatively prime to p to the alpha, z, and then, OK, this part doesn't change. Oh, I got myself turned around. I started with defining it in terms of x, so I'll stick to x. OK. But so we also have, if I write x this way, then I also have f of x is actually f of y plus f prime of y z p to the alpha mod p to the 2 alpha. So I guess this is like a p-adic Taylor expansion around y, but you can just prove it elementarily just by doing, you can just like check it by hand for a polynomial and then a rational function. So then you have that chi of f of x is chi of f of y times chi of 1 plus f prime over f of y z p to the alpha, which is going to be chi of f of y e of bz over p to the alpha. And then I can do a similar thing with the additive character. It's going to be g of y c of g prime of y z p to the alpha, which again, writing it in terms of complex exponentials, e of, what am I going to get? I'm going to get z g prime. Oh, here I guess I dropped the f prime over f. A. OK, and then we use the additive orthogonality of characters over the z. OK, if I pull the z sum in and just use orthogonality of characters, I conclude the lemma. OK, so there's really not much to it. And you can see it works in great generality. So the kind of upshot is it suffices to look at exponential sums on just on primes and not on prime powers. And typically, these exponential sums are multiplicative also. So it really, to deal with exponential sums for general modulus, the prime case is the only interesting case. Maybe I'll just say a similar lemma. If p to the 2 alpha plus 1 with alpha at least 1. OK, and then I'll just state the quadratic forms theorem that comes out of the first 40 minutes of this lecture, and that'll be it. So the theorem, OK, so I want to say it's due to Kloosterman, but it's OK, it's not exactly what Kloosterman did. So it's just let Q be a positive definite quadratic form. In R, at least four variables, then R and Q is 2 pi to the k, n to the k minus 1 over gamma of k, determinant of the associated matrix to the half. OK, and then there's some singular series, which is going to vanish or not depending on whether the quadratic form passes these local conditions, which Philippe alluded to earlier, plus a big O depending on epsilon and q of n to the k over 2 minus a quarter plus epsilon. Oh, OK, so I didn't state the bound. So you'll see in the, OK, so timeout, back up here. You'll see in the lectures that are going to come to how to bound exponential sums over primes. And so the result, which is the Weil bound, is that this Kloosterman sum for a general modulus here is bounded by the GCD of m, n, n, c to the half, c to the half, and then the number of divisors of c. OK, and then using this Weil bound in the previous machinery that I did for the first 40 minutes of the lecture, you get this result where okay, so this S N Q is the term that comes from the M equals 0 frequency, is the sum over C bigger than or equal 1, C to the minus R, a sum over D, C relatively prime to each other, a sum over H mod C, and then I get E d over c q of h mod n. OK, so here it's a sum over z mod c to the r. OK, and then, of course, factoring this, you see it only depends on q reduced all the different primes. So this is really only local information goes into the singular series. And maybe one nice thing to notice also is that if I want to extend this to r equals 3, well, then the same sort of bounds, the same sort of error term, if you kind of just guess that the same size of the main term, the same size of the error term, you'll find that it no longer suffices. If you just plug in, I guess, k was r over 2, so if I go down to 3, k would be 3 halves. Then this error term would no longer be good enough to get a main term for the three variable case. And in that case, you can actually use something, a generalization of this Petersen formula to exploit extra cancellation over that sum over C when we set up the Kloosterman method, circle method. So I think this is a kind of nice quick illustration how sums over Kloosterman sums over the modulus can give you something even if I didn't specifically do the three variable case. So I'll stop there for today, and next time we'll proved the Petersen formula.
Okay, thank you. Does anyone have a very quick question before we finish?
Everyone wants to go home.
Yeah. No. One remark is that when R is better than 4, so Kloosterman bound with 3/4 is still sufficient. So mm-hmm. Eight bound is not necessary.
Yeah, and I think you get a 1/8 instead of a 1/4 here.
Okay, I think we should call it a day there. Let's thank Ian again for a nice